Yes. So, evolution was the first concept at school that really captivated me. At about 16, it seemed relevant, and it was disruptive to my worldview at the time. So I decided I'd go to university and I'll learn more about it. So I did that. And then I take a step back and looked at the world around me. And it seemed like we weren't headed in the direction we were supposed to. This notion of survival of the fittest didn't really seem to be holding true. And I wanted to know why that was and what's gone wrong. And it's that question, why and what's gone wrong, that's put me on my current path. So the next choice, I thought, right, I'll do a PhD, I'll become a scientist, I'll find all the answers and I'll create some solutions. But as with most things, the more you learn, the more you realize you don't know. So here's what I did learn. So I started to think about human health on this continuum. We've got good health down at the bottom here in blue and bad health up at the top in orange. So we want to be down at the bottom, but I would say we're somewhere in the middle. We've got five major challenges in terms of health facing the Western world: diabetes, lung disease, cancer, heart disease, and mental health conditions. Now, this is despite the fact that there's more drugs on the market than there's ever been. There's bigger and better hospitals being built all the time, better diagnostics, better drug discovery, and better biomedical research. So we call this the top-down approach to healthcare. We pump money in at the top, and we expect it, and we get amazing innovations, but it's not working as well as it should. And I learned that the reason it's not working as well as it should is because of our environment, or environmental risk factors, as scientists call them. So let's have a look. People lead sedentary lifestyles. The food quality isn't what it was. People eat rubbish food, they drink, they're stressed out, and they smoke. So while your environment looks like this, it doesn't matter how much money you pump in at the top. Those innovations are never going to reach their full potential. So what we need is to change the environment from the bottom up. We need a bottom-up approach to healthcare. We need to change how people live and what they eat. And it's only when we apply this bottom-up approach that the top-down approach can really work. They sit side by side, and we can really start to improve the health and well-being of the human population. So when I was researching these environmental risk factors, as scientists call them, I kept coming back to food. And I learned that food has got massive implications in terms of our individual health and well-being. But I also learned that food and the food system has got massive implications in the wider environment. So I started to look at this environment. So I started with meat production. So let's take a look at this good old-fashioned quarter-pounder burger. How do we get to that? Well, first of all, we need a field. And I used to think the fields were natural landscapes, but they're not. We have to create them. And in doing so, we cut down a load of trees, wipe out a load of natural habitat, and kill a load of species. So now we've got our field, and we fill it with cows, lots and lots and lots of cows. And we've got to feed them. But they don't eat grass. Well, they do, but that's not what we feed them. We feed them grains that we fly in from all over the world, along with hormones and antibiotics. Bear in mind, those grains could have been used to feed the people in their country of origin far, far more efficiently. But instead, we bring them over, pump them into our cows with the hormones and the antibiotics to make them grow strong, quick, and protect them against disease. Then we slaughter them, put them on the back of a lorry, transport them to be processed, put them on the back of another lorry, transport them to be packaged, transport them to an aeroplane, put them on the aeroplane, and fly them all around the world until they arrive on our supermarket shelves. So what? What's wrong with that process? Well, that process I've just showed you uses 45% of the world's land. It uses 30% of the world's water. It accounts for 91% of deforestation and 51% of greenhouse gas emissions. It's the leading cause of ocean dead zones, and it's the leading cause of species extinction. So I thought, oh, well, meat's out. What about fish? After all, I'm a scientist. I know that fish are efficient protein converters. If you give a fish a kilogram of food, it'll give you a kilogram of fish meat, because they're cold-blooded and they float, so they don't really waste much energy. So then I started looking into the fishing industry. And I learned that Norway and Russia dominate that industry. And they've invested heavily in these factory ships that trawl the oceans. And we actually take about 90 million tons of fish out the water every year. But for every 1 kilogram that we take out and eat, 10 kilograms gets caught. The remaining 9 gets killed and discarded back into the sea. Very inefficient. So anyway, once this kilogram's on board, we chop the head off and take the guts out, H&G-ing they call it. And then we stick it on a ship and we sail it all the way to China. And then we take it to this factory where there's thousands of women who are very, very efficient at filleting fish, more so than a machine and cheaper. And then we freeze them into these 7.5 kilogram blocks and transport them to South Korea. Because in South Korea, they've got the world's largest cold stores, about the same size as Wembley Stadium. So we've got these huge cold stores the size of Wembley, floor to ceiling with frozen blocks of fish, and then the money men come in and start buying and selling them. And that's when they get sold into supermarket supply chains. So a fish that was caught 50 miles off the north coast of Scotland has had its head cut off and its guts ripped out, been sailed all the way to China, filleted, frozen into a block, then shipped to South Korea, bought and sold a few times, and then put on another ship and sailed back to the UK until it arrives and is sold to you as Atlantic cod. But no one knows this stuff. So not only is that completely insane, the way and the rate at which we're fishing is insane. So as I said, for every 1 kilogram we eat, 10 kilograms is caught. And since 1970, the oceans, the fishes in the ocean have depleted by 50%. That's in a generation. So we're taking fish out the ocean far, far faster than it can replenish. So it's unsustainable and it's inefficient and it's wasteful. So I thought, oh well, fish is out then. What about veg? We can't go wrong with veg, can we? So I looked at that. And because we've massively overfarmed the land, there's no natural fertility left in the soil, so we pump it full of fertilizers. And then because we grow in monoculture agriculture, we have to cake them with fertilizers, pesticides, both of which are made from fossil fuels, as is the tractor that harvests them. Then we stick them on the back of another lorry and transport this to the depot, where it's packaged, put in these plastic bags and pumped full of nitrogen to ensure a safe trip onto your supermarket shelf. And I'm not sure how many of you have ever bought a pack of spinach. You take the first leaves out and it tastes great and it's got a crunch. And you go back a couple of days later and it's all limp and mushy in the bottom of the bag. We actually throw 60% of packet lettuce in the bin. And that 60% goes to landfill. So again, a very inefficient, unsustainable and wasteless way to produce food, because we've got unnecessary packaging, insane food miles, loads of waste, and the whole system's completely dependent on fossil fuels. So I'll say it again, the way we are currently producing food is inefficient, unsustainable, and it's wasteful right now. But I haven't even told you that by 2050, we've got to feed 10 billion people, and we've got to increase food production by 70%. But I've just told you that we're already using half the world's land and 30% of the world's water, and there's only half the amount of fish that there was a generation ago. So we either need a new planet, or we need a new way to produce food. So these things were playing on my mind. They were a heavy, heavy burden. And luckily, that's when I met Jens. And so he shared that burden with me, and he shares that continues to share my burdens. So Jens had just come back from sailing around the world and trekking around Argentina on horseback to do a PhD in computational chemistry. I still don't really understand what that is. But anyway, he was troubled by some of the same issues that I was, and he was also an academic. I love that phrase, recovering academic. So he is now also a recovering academic. And we decided that we didn't just want to try and publish papers on this stuff. We actually wanted to do something about it. So That's when we discovered aquaponics. We went out and started looking for solutions to the problems. So aquaponics is a way to grow fish without taking them out the ocean. And it's a way to grow plants that isn't dependent on fossil fuel fertilizers and pesticides. So how does it work? Well, we grow fish, and fish give this waste product called ammonia. And if you leave ammonia in the water, it builds up and becomes toxic. So we pump that ammonia-rich water into a separate tank called a biofilter, and that's teeming with amazing microorganisms who convert that waste ammonia into a very useful fertilizer. Then we pump that nitrate-rich fertilizer up to our plants who've got their roots suspended in the water, and they draw out all that nutrient. So in turn, they're purifying the water for the fish. So it's a very, very efficient closed-loop ecosystem that's sustainable and scalable, and it's not wasteful. But aquaponics is just one part of a fully integrated urban farming system. So then we discovered this fully integrated urban farming system. So the main premise here is that it's not exploitative, it's connected, it's integrated, it's mirrored on nature, there's no waste. We take waste products and turn them into valuable resources. So take two waste products like coffee and cardboard, plentiful in the city. On those, we can grow mushrooms, a very, very nutritious and also a very high value crop. So once we've harvested the mushrooms, what's left? We can feed to worms. Now, worms are amazing creatures. They take waste products like what's left from the mushroom farming, and also they'll take waste food products, which are plentiful in cities, and convert them into three valuable outputs. You get possibly the best compost known to man, an organic pesticide, and a feed for your fish. So you plug that into your aquaponic system. So remember, your fish are fertilizing your plants, and your plants are purifying the water for your fish. And then you can even do clever things like take the excess oxygen from your plants and give that to your mushrooms, and then take the excess CO2 from your mushrooms and give that to your plants. And then once you've filleted your fish and your worms can't eat any more food, you plug that into an anaerobic digester, which produces all the energy to heat and power your integrated urban farm. So Jens and I thought, right, that's it, we've cracked it. We'll start building these systems, and we'll save the world. So to do that, we founded Farm Urban. So as I said, we stepped outside of academia and set up this social enterprise. And we drew up plans to convert abandoned, unused space in the city into these amazing integrated farms. And then we actually built one on the roof of the university. And it was productive, and it worked, and there was no fish being taken out of the ocean, and we were producing salad and herbs without any environmental impact. So I thought, okay, this might help us solve the production issue and the distribution issue. But what about consumption? So I'm a biologist, and my primary concern is human health. I thought, is this really going to change behavior? Is this really going to make people make better choices in terms of what they're eating? And it was my daughter, Bella, that gave me this insight. So she was 2 at the time, and I was trying to get her to eat salad and drink kale and spinach smoothies. Yeah, and she'd push it away and say, "No way, Daddy, I'm not eating that. That's disgusting." So then I took one of the aquaponic systems that we were developing, and I put it in the kitchen, much to my wife's dismay. I thought, I'll get some R&D in here. So Bella took an interest in the fish. She wanted to feed them, and she started to want to smell the leaves. And now, every morning, she feeds those fish. She picks the leaves, and we put them in a blender with an apple and a spoon of honey. And the green, frothy, earthy liquid that comes out, she drinks it with relish and says, "Daddy, that's delicious." And the reason she does that is because she's engaged with the process. She's engaged with the concept. She's connected to her food. So the reason kids don't eat healthy food is because they don't know it. So a TED hero of mine, Ron Finley, says if they grow it, they eat it. But I would add to that, if they know it, they eat it. So the reason kids know products like Coca-Cola, Nestle, and Pop-Tarts is because there's a very powerful, lucrative machine behind that. In terms of scientists messing around with the chemicals to make products that are bad for us taste good, and a very successful marketing campaign making us want to eat them. So that's what happens when you let a shareholder's return on investment determine what people are eating. After all, no one got rich telling you to eat salad and take 8 hours sleep. But that's what we need to change. And that's what I think we can change by embedding the solution to a broken food system into the fabric of society for people to see. So we did weird things like build an aquaponic system in the shape of a double helix for a life sciences college. And then we put one in the visitor center of botanical gardens for children to engage with and infographics so they could learn about it. And then we put these systems on the play decks of the children's hospital Alderhay, and the kids climb all over that system, they watch the fish being fed, and they want to taste those leaves and smell them. And then we designed an open source, very affordable, accessible, small scale system out of IKEA parts and developed a workshop around that. And now we're taking the idea of a vending machine and flipping it on its head. So instead of this being filled with crisps, chocolate, and sugar water, it's growing live salad and herbs. So I think what we need to do is take the food production out of the factory farms and the scientists' labs and put it, embed it into society for people to see and feel and taste. Thank you.